Welcome to the White House Historical Association's virtual holiday book festival. The annual holiday book festival has become a tradition for the association, but this year we're adding a virtual component. Every day this week from November 29th through December 3rd, as we welcome the public to meet our authors in person at our White House History Shop, we will also be highlighting a selection of books with virtual programming every day beginning at 12 noon. In 1962, when First Lady Jacqueline Kennedy gave Americans a televised tour of the White House interiors, she announced, "We are going to do a book." This promise became a guidebook, The White House, an Historic Guide, the Association's first project. As we celebrate our 60th anniversary, the Association has matured into a nationally recognized independent publisher with more than 60 titles produced to date, as well as a quarterly magazine now in its 63rd issue. Publications serve as a tangible representation of the Association's mission to enhance understanding, appreciation, and enjoyment of the historic White House as they have from the start. From general interest to highly focused, our titles cover a broad range of subjects related to the history of the President's House and its historic neighborhood, from its architecture, gardens, fine and decorative arts, to the presidents and first ladies who lived there over the years, to the stories of those who built and cared for the house, to its global context as the home and office of our nation's head of state. Our list includes titles that appeal to history buffs and art lovers, connoisseurs and curious amateurs, scholars and tourists, adults and children. All proceeds from the sale of the Association's books and products are used to fund the acquisition of historic furnishings and artwork for the permanent White House collection, assist in the preservation of public rooms, and further its educational mission. During our holiday book festival, many of our authors will be available to sign books at the White House History Shop at 1610 H Street Northwest. We hope you can visit and meet the authors and do some of your holiday shopping. The schedule for the event can be found at whitehousehistory.org. If you can't come in person, all of our books can be found on our website at shop.whitehousehistory.org. Stay tuned for today's featured videos. Recipes from the President's Ranch, food people like to eat. And creating a sweet world of White House desserts.
I'm Matthew Wendell, author of Recipes from the President's Ranch, Food People Like to Eat. I'm a Texan, born and bred, and my story starts there in the Lone Star State. I'm from Danbury, a small town southeast of Houston. When I was growing up in the 60s and 70s, food seemed to be at the center of nearly every activity in this farming community of about 1,200 people. There were lots of great cooks. My mother was one of them. I'm number 6 of 9 children, and my mom cranked out 3 meals a day for us. She put us to work in the kitchen as soon as she could. I remember being 5 or 6 years old and sitting on the kitchen counter, stirring a cake batter, mixing brownies or cookies, or spreading the jelly on the jelly rolls. Although my mother sold countless cakes and pies out of our home, her specialty was cinnamon rolls. They were amazing. If the windows were open, I could smell them baking before I reached the back door when I got home from school. Nearly every Sunday, my mother made fried chicken in a big black cast iron skillet. I think hers was some of the best, and I just knew that people coming out of the church across the street could smell it and wish they were coming over for lunch. At age 15, I landed my first restaurant job, working as a dishwasher in Phillips Cafe. Phillips was legendary in our county, known for grilled steak, chicken fried steak, and fried shrimp dinners, the best I ever had. The legendary Phillips cook, Bertha Stokes, was a master on the grill and taught me how to grill a proper steak. As I got older, I cooked and waitered my way through college, working for catering services and friends. And after graduation and during my career in various fields, I remained a devoted foodie. In college, I wanted to be a consumer crusader of sorts. I graduated from Southwest Texas State, currently known as Texas State, in San Marcos, with a degree in consumer sciences. But after many years in the working world, I decided I needed a change in my life and to go back to my roots. And it was while working with a catering company in Austin called Word of Mouth Catering that I was first sent to work at the Governor's Mansion. This was while George W. Bush was serving as governor, and my duties at the mansion grew to include more than waiting. I began to take on whatever task needed to be done when the family entertained, in addition to other everyday duties around the historic residence. One evening, I was at the governor's mansion cleaning up after an outdoor reception. Governor Bush came outside and began making small talk. He went on to ask, "If I were to run for president, would you think about coming with me? It would mean a lot of hard work and little pay, but an experience of a lifetime." Well, stunned, I quickly said, "Of course I would," and that I was very honored for the consideration. I was with the Bush family on election night. Like everyone else in the country, we were unsure of the outcome. Who can forget the Florida recounts? It wasn't until December 12, 2000, that we learned George W. Bush would be the 43rd President of the United States. Life was a whirlwind as I made a fast transition from packing up the governor's mansion to moving to Washington, D.C. Inauguration Day, January 20th, 2001, was cold and rainy. The day began for us at about 5 a.m. and moved fast. "I'm so honored and grateful to be here with you," I told the president-elect. He said, "I wouldn't have it any other way, Matty. I'm grateful." My duties for the Bushes were beyond cooking to include what might be called house management when they were at Camp David or their Prairie Chapel Ranch in Crawford, Texas. In truth, I was the whatever guy, doing whatever needed to be done. When I wasn't cooking for the Bush family, I acted as the senior advance representative. Later, in 2002, my title became Deputy Assistant Chief of Protocol for visits. The morning of September 11, 2001 was crisp and clear, and there wasn't a cloud in the sky over Washington. When I arrived at my office, the television was on. A plane had just crashed into one of the World Trade Center towers. The thought of a terrorist attack on the United States didn't even cross my mind until that day. Members of the Secret Service's Uniform Division came rushing into our offices, telling us that another plane was headed our way and ordering us to run as fast as possible away from the White House. I ran with a group of people out of the East Wing into McPherson Square Park a couple of blocks away. Smoke rose in the distance. It was the Pentagon burning. The next morning, I rode a nearly empty bus to the White House. We had a new perimeter. I showed my White House identification and was allowed through the checkpoint. Once inside, I got word that President Bush wanted to go to Camp David that weekend to meet with his advisors. Mrs. Bush wanted to have a simple menu like burgers and fried chicken, comfort foods of sort. That Thursday morning, I arrived at Camp David in a secure car with an Army sergeant who drove me through the multiple checkpoints heavily guarded by Marines with bomb-sniffing dogs. It felt like I was entering a military base in a war zone. In essence, I guess I was. At Camp David, the guests eat at one large table, and meals are served family style. Mrs. Bush's choice of comfort food for that weekend aimed to ease some of the stress and sadness that everyone is feeling. I had never expected anything like an attack on our nation to happen, and now I was to prepare and serve foods that would not only comfort but sustain the people who were making the hardest decisions of their lives, decisions that would affect our country forever. As far as I can tell, I'm the only civilian to have been at Camp David on a regular basis to cook for a president. At the White House, the food was prepared by a team of trained chefs and was a bit fussier. It had to be, but at Camp David, the Bushes wanted relaxed, casual food. Many people assumed that I cooked at the White House, but actually, that was something that did not interest me. I was happy cooking at Camp David and Prairie Chapel Ranch and taking care of the first family and their guests in a more personal setting. That's how I could serve them best, as I had done in Austin. I was always impressed by the way Mrs. Bush entertained at Prairie Chapel Ranch in Crawford, Texas. She has a West Texas grace that I call simple elegance, never too fussy, with clean lines and calming colors. Simple elegance may have been guests' impression of the ranch, but preparing for a trip by the first family was complicated, involving managing many moving parts. It was my job to have everything ready when the president and Mrs. Bush arrived. For a routine visit to the ranch, I flew either to Dallas or Austin a couple of days before the Bushes, and I hit the ground running. I would begin with my shopping and became efficient at it. I went to the same grocery stores, and because I got to know their layouts, I prepared my shopping list to match. I didn't have the luxury of running back to the store if I forgot something, and I always made sure to keep backups of the basics. In the spring and summer, I also went to the local farmers markets in Waco. There I found a treasure trove of amazing fruits and vegetables, such as black-eyed peas, yellow squash for baked squash casserole, and Texas Hill Country peaches at their peak of freshness to make one of the family favorites, Laura Bush's peach cream pie. The other place I shopped for the Bushes was a local religious community called Homestead Heritage. They had a water-powered grist mill for grinding organically grown grains such as wheat, oats, and corn. I have never had better flour for baking bread, better cornmeal for cornbread, or better pastry flour for making the flakiest pie crust. Unless there was a specific request for something like steaks, or we were having a certain guest coming to stay at the ranch, Mrs. Bush pretty much left it up to me to decide what to prepare. I had been with the family long enough to know their favorite dishes and even what their regular guests and friends liked. I always tried to prepare whatever was seasonal and fresh, as I know that's the key to making good, tasty food. Holidays were a special time at the ranch. The Bushes loved being with family, friends, and each other. They never celebrated Christmas at the ranch, however. That was always at Camp David, and they came to the ranch the day after Christmas. They usually stayed until New Year's Eve. Easter was one of my favorite holidays at the ranch. The weather was almost always nice, and sometimes the Texas bluebonnets and other native wildflowers would be already in full bloom. Jenna Hawkins Welch, Mrs. Bush's mother, came for Thanksgiving and Easter until she was unable to travel. She was a very kind and smart woman, and in fact, gave me part of the title for this book. She used to say, "Matthew, you just make food people like to eat." It was a high compliment coming from her. The ranch was the perfect place for diplomacy. I have always thought that food is a great equalizer and that sharing a meal together can bring people together. In 2002, President and Mrs. Bush had four official visitors to the ranch: Saudi King Abdullah, Saudi Prince Bandar, Chinese President Jiang Zemin, and British Prime Minister Tony Blair. The Blairs' visit was a bit different from the others because they brought their two youngest children, one still using a high chair at the table. We served the Blairs beef tenderloin smoked with pecan wood from the ranch. It would later become a signature dish that I served to many foreign guests. That night's entertainment was a Western swing trio, Daddy Rabbit, out of San Antonio. Mr. Blair even sang and played the guitar as all the guests came out to listen. The year 2003 was busy with diplomatic visits. The next year, the Bushes had only three official visits. In 2005, most of the foreign leaders came for a day trip to the ranch, and President and Mrs. Bush served lunch in the breezeway. In this informal setting, we were able to accommodate more guests. In May 2007, President and Mrs. Bush hosted the NATO Secretary General Jaap de Hoop Scheffer, followed by German Chancellor Angela Merkel in November. An interesting exchange took place while I was preparing a pecan-smoked beef tenderloin for the evening dinner. I was at the barbecue pit, a short distance from the main house, and had just started the searing process when President Mrs. Bush and Chancellor Merkel and her husband, Dr. Joachim Sawyer, stopped by to see what I was up to. Chancellor Merkel was very curious about the technique, asking lots of questions about the method I was using to prepare the main course. She was especially impressed that I was using pecan wood from trees right there on the ranch to impart that smoky flavor. The Chancellor shared that she loved grilling out as well. Doesn't everyone? For most of the luncheons we had at the ranch, cheeseburgers were on the menu, even when world leaders were visiting. I learned that they love cheeseburgers just as much as the rest of us. A reporter once wrote an article called Cheeseburger Diplomacy during the time President Bush was in office. Universal love for cheeseburgers really brings home the power of sharing a meal. An act as old as humankind. It's a sort of equalizer. At the ranch, my sweet and smoky cheeseburgers were a staple and our little tradition that I think world leaders looked forward to. Then, there we were again on another inauguration day. This time, however, the ceremony was for Barack Obama and the Bushes were leaving the White House. For 8 exciting years, we had full run of the White House and all that comes with it. Now, it was someone else's turn. I had put my whole heart and soul into working for the president, and I knew what a privilege it was. In one sense, the 8 years had gone quickly, but 8 years also feels long at the intensity level required. I was tired. I boarded the plane, which was then called Special Air Mission 28,000, instead of Air Force One, because it no longer carried a current president. I realized that this most amazing and unexpected chapter of my life was coming to a close. As the plane lifted off, I took a deep breath and let out a sigh of both relief and gratitude. The kitchen management wisdom and good food I serve the Bushes are still a part of what I can offer. This book tells my story and shares my favorite recipes, those I like to prepare and the Bush family like to eat. They are not hard to make, and I hope you will enjoy them too. Thank you.
Hello, I am Chef Roland Mesnier, former White House pastry chef. During the 26 years I worked at the White House, I had the opportunity to prepare dessert for 5 presidents, their families, and countless head of states and VIPs. I tried to create something beautiful and unique for every occasion. Many of these are featured in my book, A Sweet World of White House Dessert. One of my favorite chapters tells the story of the Orange Surprise. First Lady Nancy Reagan undoubtedly put her stamp on White House entertaining, for she influenced the way food was prepared and presented well beyond the Reagan year. From day one, it was understood that she would have to approve each menu item for every special luncheon and dinner in advance of the event. So we set up elaborate tasting for her, preparing an entire meal for 8 to 10 people. The Orange Surprise was created for the Prime Minister of Japan and his wife. I made oversized blown sugar orange and carefully removed the top with a special saw. Each one was about the size of a cantaloupe. They were frozen and sprayed with orange colored chocolate so that the surface resembled the peel of a real orange. They were filled with a gianduja mousse mixed with caramelized chocolate almond clusters. The mousse was then topped with orange sorbet, fresh orange segment, and peel garnish the platter. I treasured this photo of Mrs. Reagan enjoying the dessert, with the Prime Minister looking on. The butler told me that Mr. Nakasone asked Mrs. Reagan, "Where do you grow such big oranges?" And she replied, "Only in California, only in California."
Mark Ramsdell, pastry chef and instructor, and Chef Mesnier's longtime White House Gingerbread House collaborator, introduces the book with his reflections. This is about an era of magnificent White House desserts, when executive pastry chef Roland Mesnier brought breathtaking and delicious endings to thousands of dinners. Serving 5 presidents and their guests for more than 25 years, Chef Mesnier brought the final and memorable spark to official as well as informal events. The one-of-a-kind creations he shares in this book reflect the end of a chapter in culinary history. Chef Mesnier started working in a pastry shop when he was 12 and became an apprentice at 14. After the traditional years of lengthy training, he was awarded the title chef at 35. Today, pastry chefs frequently rely on recipes as they are written without pushing the possibilities. Chef Mesnier could imagine an ambitious dessert and invent a mold or a method to create it. But pastry chefs today generally design their presentations around readily available prefabricated supplies. This is very different from designing a concept and figuring out how to make it happen. As I often told my own culinary students, perhaps the gold medal should go to the mold maker rather than the pastry chef. During his years at the White House, Chef Mesnier's legendary desserts became highly anticipated. The souvenir menus at each place setting didn't offer the guest any clues about the components of the dessert to come. There was always a hushed excitement in the dining room at the moment of service, as the servers arrived with large platters holding dramatic creations. The lights might be dimmed and the band might launch into an appropriate tune as the guests begin to ooh and ah, applaud and cheer while rising from their seats to capture the scene with their cameras. culinaries have observed that guests will usually remember most the first and last things that they ate at a dinner party. The guests who experienced the Meznier White House dessert will undoubtedly remember it for the rest of their lives. With this book, Chef Meznier reveals many of the secrets of his life's work for the first time. Thank you for joining the White House Historical Association's 2021 Virtual Holiday Book Festival. We hope that today's selected videos about our books have served to shine a light on some of the many special chapters in White House history. With that in mind, we will close today's program with reflections from Stuart Stevens, who devoted his career to ensure that the light shined brightly in the President's house.
The light make chandeliers. Chandeliers don't look all that good in the dark. But when you clean them, polish them, and you clean the bulbs and things, put new bulbs in them, it really makes the White House. It lights it up. And when they are polished, they pick up all of the pieces, like the colors of the rugs and the color of the flag and the color. They just pick up that like a diamond. You know, the chandelier makes the White House because it lights it up. And when it's lit up for a steak dinner, oh man, I tell you, you could see it from Pennsylvania Avenue. The place just lit up, just beautifully.